Hello everybody! This will be the first in a series of 3 or 4 videos exploring deeply all the path effects present in the latest version of Inkscape. My idea is not go over every single option and button, because many of those options are not that useful or important, but rather show you everything you need to use each path effect in real life, as well as some practical tips and techniques that are essential to use them to the fullest. But before that, I want to remind you that I make videos on Inkscape and illustration every week, so if you're interested, subscribe to the channel and hit the bell for more tutorials. And also, since you're there, a like and comment will help me and the channel a lot, and it's always highly appreciated. Okay, let's begin. First of all, let's define exactly what are path effects. Path effects are a feature on Inkscape that allows you to do some really awesome operations on paths. I like to think of them as extra tools that you use to do some particular things, but with the added benefit that they are non-destructive, meaning that at any time you can delete the path effect and all the changes made to the path are reverted, and that you can stack them one on top of another to get different results. To open the path effect dialog, go to Path, Path Effects. If you have selected a path, you will have the option to click on this arrow to show all the effects that you can apply to the selected object. You'll notice that each effect is separated in categories by the type or use. You have the Edit Tools category, the Store, Generate, Convert, and then you have an Experimental Effects category that could potentially not work as intended, so they are not recommended to use. The way these tutorials are going to work is that I will be dedicating one video to each category, and on this video, I will go over the effects in the Edit Tools category. In the upcoming ones, I go over the other categories. Starting with the most complex and arguably the most important of the category, the Corners effect. This effect allows you to round or flatten any corner automatically, with the flexibility of changing it anytime you want. It's really helpful and it can save you hours of work. Once that you apply it to a path, you'll see this little white circle right next to every single node. From that, you can use the node tool to change the shape of the corners with a little white circle. Very similar to the way you can round off the corners of the built-in rectangle. But of course, now you can use it with any path, not just rectangles. If you're interested in making all the corners to be equal, then the most important option will be this one, Radius. Here you can set the radius value that all corners of the path will receive. And down here you can set the unit. I would recommend you to always work on pixels. By default, you apply a fillet, which means rounding off the edges, but here at the bottom you have the option to change it to a chamfer, which means just straightening out the edges. You also have the option to apply an inverse fillet, which just inverts the rounding, a bit less useful but still a kinda cool option to have, and an inverse chamfer, which seems like it does nothing right now, but that leads us to another option here, chamfer steps. A chamfer operation looks flat only when this value is set to 1, but we can change it to make it look like a stepped version of the chamfer. Going back to the inverse chamfer option, now you can clearly see what it does. It just inverts it, like with the inverse fillet option. This final option is really important, this one that says change only selected nodes. By enabling this box, you can apply the radius and, most importantly, the corner types to individually selected corners. This way you get to mix and match different type of corners in a single path, really unlocking the power of this path effect. And those were the most important options for this effect. Everything else you can leave it as it is. You can safely ignore them. Next is the power stroke effect. This allows you to change the shape of a line or a stroke. Most of the time you want to apply it to an open path that simulates being a line, to make it look more like a traditional media stroke, though you can apply it to a closed path with some caveats. Once applied, you get a red dot for each node. You can move them around to create the shape you want. You're not limited to the amount of dots you have. If you hold Ctrl and click on a dot, a new one will be created when you drag from it. You can pull as many nodes as you need to sculpt the shape you want. And one important thing, the dots are not limited to the segment they were created in. You can drag them all throughout the stroke, so you have that complete freedom. Of course, you still have access to the stroke. You can still manipulate it with the object and node tool, add nodes, move the curvature, and all the changes you made with the effect will adapt to this new shape. So, as you can see, this is a really powerful tool to get interesting shapes for a line. It is possible that you make the line too thick to be seen or manipulated easily. In that case, I would recommend you to enable this option here in the tool controls of the node tool. This will allow you to see the path outline clearly on top of the effect. It is important to note that when you apply this effect to a stroke, the actual shape that you're manipulating with the dots, it's another path that Inkscape places right on top of the stroke, even if it does not show on the layers and object dialog. That means that you no longer change the width with the fill and stroke dialog. Instead, you control the overall thickness with this input box. All the bumps and form changes you did will be kept when you change the thickness. One thing to keep in mind, because this shape is a path, if you want to change color, now you have to apply it to the fill instead of the stroke. And what's more, you can even give it a stroke and change its color and width using the fill and stroke dialog, like with any other object. You can get some interesting looks with this. And that was it for this effect. All the other options, you can skip them. Let's continue with the knot effect. This one is pretty simple. Basically, it allows you to create a space in the intersection between lines, like in Celtic designs. This effect works with single paths that have overlapping strokes, whether they are closed or open. Unlike with the previous effect, it does not create a shape on top of the strokes, meaning that you can work on the original path normally. After you apply it, you should see how there is a bit of a gap in the intersections to show how one line goes over another. Also notice how they are switching between going on top and above, like in the classic Celtic designs. Of course, you can still manipulate the strokes with the node tool, and the intersections will arrange themselves automatically to this back and forth. When you switch to the node tool, you should see this big round arrow. This arrow will show on the very first intersection, and by clicking on it, you can set up which line goes on top or below on that intersection, so you can make it fit with all the other ones. You can also disable the effect as well, but only for this first intersection. It would have been nice to have this option for each intersection, but I guess the effect is only meant for a very particular type of knot design. There are only two options that are worth knowing on this effect. First, with the gap length, you can make the spacing longer. And second, the gaps in both will make it so both lines have a gap. But there is a feature you should be aware of when using it. Remember that this effect only works on single paths. It does not interact with other objects. If you want multiple objects to interact with each other, you can combine the path into a single one. Just select the two shapes and go to Path, Combine. This will join the two paths into a single path made of two islands. Even if they don't look like it, now they are a single path, so the knot effect will work as intended. Simplify is the path effect version of the simplify operation in the path menu, but in real time and with a few more options. This operation will simplify a complex model by smoothing it. It's very important to know that this operation will not remove unnecessary nodes. What it does is to smooth out a path. It's clearly meant to be used with organic shapes, like the ones you draw using the pencil tool. That's why it's built into that tool. You can see it in the tool controls, and even enable the path effect version with this button. The blue markers indicate the virtual nodes that the operation is using to simplify. It's only a visual feature, you cannot edit them. The only two options that seem to do something are the complexity, which apparently defines how much simplification is doing, though to me it just crashes the program if I dare as much as to touch it, and smoothing, which defines how much it smooths sharp corners, that is, how much it destroys the original shape. I'm gonna be honest, I don't use this effect at all. This is because it's more useful when you use the pen tool to draw with a tablet. I don't like to draw with a tablet in Inkscape, and honestly, I don't recommend it. What I can tell you is that this effect is by far the one that most consistently crashed my system. The offset effect is similar to the simplify effect in the sense that it seems to be the path effect version of a path operation as well. In this case, the dynamic offset. But again, with the added benefit of being non-destructive, which is especially important for this operation. Once you apply this effect and switch to the node tool, you should see this orange circle. By pulling from it, you can offset the shape from all sides equally. There is no need to touch anything in the settings, everything just works out of the box, but if you're not satisfied with the way some super sharp corners look, you can play around with the join options, though to me everything just works as it is. The final effect in this category is the taper stroke. And I already mentioned this effect when we talked about the power stroke, basically saying that it's a simpler version of that effect. Taper stroke will apply a taper to any stroke you make. It's meant to make the lines created with the pen tool look like natural media, maybe like a pen or a brush. In certain ways, it is more useful than the power stroke because making tapered lines is way more common than making custom lines. After it's been applied, you control the taper with this little diamond. Unlike with the power stroke, you cannot move this control past the end node. So if you want a nice and long taper, you have to keep in mind the position of the nodes. The most important setting you have to care for in the effects dialog is this one, that controls the width. Just like the power stroke effect, taper stroke will transform the stroke into a path that you can edit as a normal stroke, though just like before you'll have to change the color as a fill and you won't be able to use some features of the stroke style tab in the fill and stroke dialog. Because you may want to use thick strokes with this effect, the other option that you may want to keep an eye on is the join type. Extrapolated works most of the time, but if that doesn't work for you, you may want to try some of the others. And that was it for this video on the Edit Tools Path Effects. We'll move on to the next category, which is the Distort Effects. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like and comment. It helps it getting seen by other people. Also, don't forget to subscribe for more tutorials on Inkscape and illustration. That was it for now. See you in the next video. Bye.